Today I'm going to go through how to build a 60% mechanical keyboard. I've been reviewing keyboards from banggood.com for a while, and thanks again for their continued support. And I noticed that they have several parts to make a keyboard, so that's what we're going to do today, and it's absolutely nothing to be scared of. Probably the biggest hurdle is having access to soldering equipment, because all we're doing is the simplest of through-hole soldering. And this truly is the gateway to much bigger things in keyboards. 60% boards aren't for everyone though, but these are by far the cheapest to make and has the most universal and interchangeable parts available, allowing for greater customizability. Alright, so let's go through the parts. Again, this is all sourced from banggood.com, but there are so many other vendors out there with many more different parts and of course higher quality, more exotic and expensive stuff. First we have our PCB, which stands for printed circuit board. This is the very common and accessible Satan GH60 60% PCB, and this will connect all the electronic components together. And this is only one out of many different PCBs you can get. Next we need our key switches. I have 87 Gateron black key switches, which is more than enough for our 61 key keyboard. We can use any Cherry MX style switch. This includes Altimuse, Gateron, KL, Gritech, whatever you want. We then need a mounting plate to mount our switches on. This is the very common 60% aluminium plate that's available on all Chinese websites and eBay and all that. And these three colors are probably the most common out there, and they support various layouts. To stabilize the longer keycaps, we need stabilizers. Cherry style stabilizers are very easy to obtain. If it doesn't say they're genuine, then they're just copies like these. These still of course work, but tend to be more rattly. So try to get genuine if possible. We need a case to fit everything in. This is a Poker 2 style plastic case in white. All these 60% cases should have this standoff layout, so just double check that the screw holes are the same. Alternatively, you can make your own case. And finally, to top it off, we need some keycaps. Now to the equipment needed. To do this, we need a soldering station. It's best to get a proper variable temperature station rather than just the irons that plug straight into the wall. And this is to keep temperatures safe to avoid damaging your parts. Input Club have a great list of soldering equipment which you can check out, but definitely the most recommended and the best value soldering station is the Hakko FX888D, so if you can get that for a good price, then just get that and you'll be happy. We then need some solder wire. If you can, then get the ones that Input Club recommend, but you basically want leaded solder. The numbers like 60-40 or 63/37 just refers to the percentage of SM, which is tin, to PB, which is lead. Both is absolutely fine, and we want a rosin core solder which has flux in it. We also want a solder sucker to fix up any mistakes, a pair of tweezers, and some flush cutters. Okay, so now that we have everything, the first thing I recommend is testing your PCB. Without it, it all means nothing. So to test it, open up a keyboard tester on your computer, plug the PCB in, grab your tweezers and individually just touch the two points with the tweezers and each key should register. The GH60 is the most common PCB out there and provides everything that we need, so we already have the controller, diodes, resistors and all soldered in already, leaving us just the job of putting in switches and LEDs if we want to. Now to the stabilizers. These are Cherry style stabs and are pre-assembled. You can also get them apart. For a normal 60% to a 10 keyless keyboard, we usually need 4 2-unit stabs and 1 6.25-unit stab, which will usually come in a set. If you have different requirements like a larger spacebar or a slightly different layout, then make sure you consider that. An optional stage is to clip the stabilizers. Basically, there's these two long prong things that act as a kind of dampener for the stabilizers, and it can make the stabilizer keys feel kind of mushy, so just take them apart and keep a stabilizer intact for reference, and we just need to snip off the pieces that look like this. And it should look a little something like this when it's done. This isn't absolutely necessary, but you might as well do it to get a sharper feel, and you won't be able to do this later. When that's done, we pop them onto the PCB. Make sure you go to the top side, which is the one without all the components on it. There are two holes for these, with one small and one large. The bit that looks like this will go into the smaller hole, and the other end just slides into the larger ones. So we slide it into the larger hole first, then push the other side in firmly. And it won't fit in the other way, so don't worry. Now to the switches. There are two types of switches. There is plate mounted and PCB mounted. If you have no mounting plate, then get PCB mount switches. But if you have a plate like we have here, then it doesn't really matter. PCB mount switches will have these two prongs which you can easily cut off to make them plate mounted, and that really is the only difference between the two. This PCB though has the holes for PCB mount switches, so you can go without a plate if you want to, and you also don't need to cut off the prongs. We now have to join the plate to the PCB. There's so many plate options out there in terms of materials. This will change the weight, feel, and sound characteristics of the keyboard. Since the switches I have are plate mounted switches, this makes this step just a touch more difficult. Put some switches into the corners of the plate. Some holes on the plate have several mounting positions, like on the bottom row, so make sure that you put them in the right place, which I embarrassingly didn't do in my lack of attention. You can test if the placement is correct by putting some keycaps on. If you have PCB mount switches, then you can squeeze the PCB and plate together and it will lock in place. However, this won't lock in place because I have plate mount switches, so to do that we have to solder some in. So now to the soldering. This is the only thing that will prevent people from doing this besides the costs. We only need to do very simple through-hole soldering, but I absolutely recommend you go out and watch a bunch of soldering tutorial videos before attempting anything. I could spend ages on talking about this stuff, but I don't want it to be a soldering tutorial. EEVblog has a great in-depth tutorial, and Joe from Juju Cables will have a great video specifically about soldering and keyboards coming soon, and I'll link those in the description. First, we need to set our temperature. All stations are different, especially the cheaper ones, so find a low temperature where the solder melts. This is usually at about 350 degrees Celsius, but it may still be not enough, so I tend to go around 370-ish, with 400 being the max. I'm only borrowing a friend's station because I broke mine, and I only have a conical tip on this, but it's recommended to use a small chisel tip. I'm using 0.5mm wire, which is quite thin, and this allows you to more easily control the amount of solder you feed, however it is slower. For switches, up to 0.8mm is pretty good and is faster, so you don't need to spend as much time on the joints, which reduces the risk of damage. To solder, all we need to do is place our tip on the pad, which is the circle thing around the rim of the hole on the PCB, and also make contact with the pin itself. Then from the other side, come in with your solder and feed it through until you get a nice amount on there. There's a great article on Adafruit about solder joints, but basically we just want a clean concave cone type of shape. If you don't have enough solder on there, then you can just reflow the joint and feed a bit more in, and if you think you have too much, then grab a solder sucker, reflow the joint and just suck it out, and then redo it. This is all very easy, and we just want to reduce the time our iron is on the PCB to avoid any potential damage, like lifting the pads on the PCB. As long as you stick to a reasonable temperature with probably 400 degrees Celsius being the maximum, and only leaving your iron on for a few seconds at a time, then it all should be fine. If you're ever in doubt, then just take the iron off the PCB, wait for a second, and then go again. You have to make sure that your switches are all the way in. Now with that all done, you can chuck it into your case. There's so many choices out there with cases. We can get some nice hefty metal ones, we can get thick acrylic cases, or we can go with wood. The cool thing is that these cases are universal, allowing you to use what you want. Probably the most accessible place to get a wide variety of cases on the cheap would be AliExpress, but there's also more specialized vendors which I'll leave a link in the description. And finally, slap on those keycaps. These are some blank tops with front printing and are pretty decently thick PBT keycaps. If you're going with a standard ANSI build like mine, then pretty much every key set will be compatible. There's also a couple more sets on Banggood. If you have a different layout in mind, then obviously make those changes when purchasing keycaps. And that's basically it. Again, the biggest hurdle is having access to soldering equipment, because the whole process is truly easy and doable and is all a bit of fun. The PCB has a default profile on it as well, but you can flash some new firmware on it if you wish, and I'll put some links in the description for that. All these parts I picked out from Banggood.com, and they do have other parts as well, so thanks again for their continued support, and I'll leave all the links in the description. But the beauty of building a 60% keyboard is that there's so many different options and parts you can source, from a heap of vendors, and you could easily spend hundreds upon hundreds of dollars. The parts I have are pretty lightweight, with the aluminium plate and plastic case, and is probably one of the cheaper configurations, and the colours don't really match, but I don't really care. A black or red case would probably look much better, and I guess I can always paint. The Gator on Black switches though are great stock linear switches, and are very smooth, and I absolutely recommend them. I also added an LED for the caps lock, and ended up lubing the stabilizers because they were pretty bad. And here's a quick sound test. It's really nice getting this video done because now I can show off some other builds coming up, so stay tuned for that. Again, the Sydney Mechanical Keyboard Meetup is coming up in July, as well as the Perth Meetup, so come along if you're nearby. Links will be in the description.